My name is Supa Bwe, Supa Boo, Supa Bwe. I pop one, I pop two, I pop three. Magic.
Yeah, my name is Supa Bwe. It's spelled B-W-E. It has a lot of different iterations. It could be boy, boo, or bwe. It's inspired by my father slash Dragon Ball Z slash just growing up in the streets and getting out of it unscathed damn near, you know. My father is a very dynamic, vibrant man, strong man, move maker, money maker. And he, in my eyes, he was always Superman, you know, came from nothing, made a lot of shit happen off of nothing. That's some real stoic shit. And then as far as like being influenced by Dragon Ball Z, there's a villain called Boo, Super Boo. And Boo was so hard because that nigga was just bad magic incarnated, just real angry, bad magic. And his final form was just this little tyrannical kid. And I really identified with that as a kid because like, that's how I felt as like when I moved to Oak Park and started going to like a school with like white kids. I came from like an all black neighborhood to like a very diverse, like mostly white neighborhood. And I just felt like just like a real ball of fucking bad magic and like nobody really understood, you know. But yeah, origins of my name, my father in Dragon Ball Z. I was like 11 through 12. I came from like the hood, like Chicago Ave and Lockwood, the west side of Chicago. And it was really tumultuous, you know, loud, hard to kind of find a way. You know, my mother's from England, my father's from the hood. So like I had a very weird household and a lot of people didn't understand, you know, the difference. And when I moved to Oak Park, it was hard to adjust because by the time like I got used to the hood and I hardened myself, I moved to Oak Park where like that hardness had no place. You know, it was just really rough. It was hard to become a man. You know, you're 11, you start feeling your nuts and shit. Girls are all of a sudden sexy instead of cute. And white girls are terrified of you because you're a hood nigga. And hood niggas not scared of you because you speak properly, and you just kind of like, damn, like where do I stand? Like where am I? You know, home was also tumultuous. My mom is from Liverpool, and my dad is from the South Side in Chicago. And you know, my mom is just very a well-read woman, very articulate, really, really cultured, very cultured woman. And my dad, not to say he's not cultured, he's just a simpler man comparatively. And you know, growing up, I just had the best of both worlds. You know, I had someone pushing like the academic side, trying to make sure I was staying focused, always learning, always reading. And then I had my father who was just like, don't be a pussy. Like, you know, them niggas just took your Pokemon cards. Go fight or you can't like have no more Pokemon cards. Like, go run that lap, like go play football, go be, stop, you know, stop staying in the house. So, you know, growing up in the house, I feel like a lot of people, a lot of American, a lot of boys, a lot of men grow up that way where it's just like, you know, the father who's just like, you're gonna be me, you're gonna be a little fucking me, you little fuck. And then the mother who's just like, I love you so much, be anything, you know. A lot of rock, hella Rick James, Papa Roach, fucking Prince, fucking Metallica, Machine Head, motherfucking Fleetwood Mac, all types of shit. I just very diverse, you know. My father, again, it was like a prominent hood nigga, like so like couldn't filter it out of his life. So it would be me and my grandma, my proper grandma, and like all these like people on my mom's side of family. My dad's like playing fucking like Eazy-E, like bitches ain't shit but hoes and tricks. You know what I mean? And my grandma's like, oh, this song makes my skin crawl. My dad just like loves that gutter, real nasty shit. Whereas like with my mom, like I feel like she played a lot of just like things that like kind of allowed you to be introspective, allowed you to look in yourself and like reflect, self-reflecting music. I grew up just like actually feeling like fuck my life like all the time. What's that fucking song, cut my life into pieces? No, is that Papa Roach, this is my last resort? Like that's when I was little, like I used to sit there just like, this is me, he gets it, you know what I mean? Like what's that Limp Bizkit song where he's like, Dana, it's just one of those days where you don't want to wake up, everything is fucked, everybody sucks. Like break stuff by Limp Bizkit. I used to listen to shit like that because like I used to just be so fucking pent up and angry as a kid, and like it was just like cool to like have that kind of like outlet, you know. So I feel like that kind of shit prevents people from doing like insane crazy shit. I went to one of my favorite shows. I went to a Killswitch Engage show, and who was there? Dragon Force. He is legend. I think Machine Head may have played. I can't remember. And that was one of my favorite things. But before hip hop or anything, I never went to a rap show until I was like 18, 19. I was already an adult before I ever went to a rap show. But with rock, I was going to rock shows since I was like a kid. You know, like, I always loved rock shows. The energy was awesome. Like rap shows fucking suck. Rappers suck. It's boring. I don't want to see a motherfucker rap over their track, walk back and forth, like maybe skip across the stage one time, you know, one, two, three, let's go, fucking just boring trash. And with rock shows, like the rock stars are jumping in the fucking crowd, they're going crazy, like pants tight, hair stupid, you know, after the show they're gonna get fucked up with you. Like it's a real like camaraderie attached to it, whereas like with rap, everybody just wants to be a fucking star, everybody's like just trying to upgrade their shades and you know, their wrist. You feel me? It was Hollywood Halt and Lady Sovereign. And like, I wasn't a fan or nothing like that. I liked Lady Sovereign because she was from England. My mom's from England. I was like, oh, this like fucking girl's from England raps and shit. Like, let me go check it out. And I thought she was cute as hell. I remember I went to the show, and afterwards, it was at Metro. And I asked her to sign my arm. Lady Sovereign was signing my arm. And I leaned forward. I was like, give me a kiss. And she was about to kiss me, bro. She was leaning forward and about to give me a kiss. I was so juiced up. Hollywood Hulk came and muffed the shit out of me out of nowhere. And he was like, get this fucker out of here. And security came and escorted me out. And I was mad as hell. And I was like, if I ever see that nigga again, I'm gonna beat his ass. And then like, I remember I started rapping and shit. I found out who he was and shit. And I was like, damn, I can't attack this nigga. Cause then like, everybody's gonna hate me. But yeah, that was the first rap show I went to. I saw Hollywood Hulk. And the whole time I was like, damn, like, I really like this nigga. Like, this is cool. Like, this rap shit is raw. Like, this is kind of like rock and roll, but it's not as lit. But like, this is cool. Like, I like his energy and shit. And then that nigga muffed. And then like, I got over it. You know, this was so long ago. It was like 15 years ago or some shit, 10 years ago, I don't know. But yeah, that nigga muffed me, bro. I was gonna stab him. I was so mad. I was like, Lady Sovereign, wow. It's just like at that time, like I was just so like, it was like, I almost cried, bro. Like he muffed me, and I was first of all salty. I was like, okay, I was about to get kissed by a star. She cool as hell. Like I was gonna get a kiss, and then like second of all, it was like everybody around. So like you just disrespected like my nuts. We niggas, like you just gonna smack me all in my face. You gonna put your hands all in my face, nigga. All near my. It wasn't like just like a dink. It wasn't like the tip of the fingers. It was a full like, my neck popped a little bit. You know how you do this? And it's like clook clook. He popped my shit, bro. It took me out of my comfort zone. I was uncomfortable as fuck. And then security came and grabbed me after that. So I'm just like, it was all these things happening. I'm just like, that's one of my kids, bro. Like, no, I'm just embarrassed. Shit. I'm trying not to cry and shit. My voice cracking. I'm like, John, get my phone. John, get my phone. It was terrible. But no, we're cool. You know, I see that nigga afterwards. I was like, nigga, you remember you muffed me? He was like, nope. And I was like, well, let me not. Okay. I guess that's where that ends. You know, I'm not like, no, nigga. No, you muffed me, nigga, in 2007, nigga. Like, it's 2015, I need vengeance, nigga. Like, yeah, I just took that L, I got muffed. Throughout that growth period of just like becoming sentient, you know, reaching like maturity, I've always tried to do music. It didn't really turn into a full-blown effort until like, I'd say 2012. But from the time of like 2007, between 2007 and like 2004, I was always just trying to form bands, trying to find other kids. Oh, you play guitar? Oh, you play bass? You play drums? Come fuck with me. Come over here. Like, come over. Let's go meet up somewhere else. La 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 la. And before I ever rapped, I was in like two or three bands, like metal bands, full metal, like screamo, 2007 shit. Like one guy singing like real like sissy, and then the other guy's just like, you know. And that shit was so fun. I love it. But it just never went anywhere. I'm black, so like everybody was just like, fuck is this black guy screaming? Fuck you, black guy, get out of here. So I was like, you know, fuck rock and roll. No one appreciates me. I'm going to go rap now. You know, every artist is like every year, it's like you see an interview or like you get a good show that goes well and you're like, I'm gonna do this forever. I'm gonna do this forever. And then you get depressed. No, I'm not gonna do this. But like when it was like forever, forever, I used to work at the Hard Rock Hotel downtown Chicago. And this cook kept calling me a nappy-headed motherfucker. He didn't say nigga until I beat his ass. But like he kept talking about my hair and just being like, oh, you need to wrap your hair up when you're delivering food. Who wants pubes in their hair? Saying shit like that, you know? And like, it was just like fucking eat at my soul every day. And I used to like only go to work to sell cocaine and weed because like everybody in the kitchen does drugs. And so like, I sold all my drugs. I didn't really want to be at work no more. And I was just thinking, you know, like my ex-girlfriend had just cheated on me, like my ex-ex. And this motherfucker just, he pushed some food on my hand and the plate was hot. And I grabbed the plate and dropped that bitch because it was just too hot. I'm And he's like, oh, you stupid motherfucker, pube head, la, 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 la. And I just like kind of blanked out. And when I like came back to, you know how you just feel like, oh, I'm fucking up. And he was just on the ground. I'm just on his ass. And I'm just like, oh, God damn it. You know what I mean? And so I just ran out that bitch. I just started running. I left my shit in the locker. I left everything. I just ran out that bitch. I never had a job again. I just quit. I was like, fuck this shit. Like, I can't do this. Like, every job I ever had, I get fired for some fuck shit. It just be like, it's just something horrible happens and I come back to it. And I'm just like, oh, God. Like, I'm about to go to jail. I can't go back to the Hard Rock Hotel. And now I was walking home. And I was like, damn, like, I ain't got no fucking money. I'm working hard. Like, I was going to school. I was working. I had this ungrateful bitch I was with. And I was just like, I'm about to just, like, destroy all this shit. I'm going to just destroy my relationship. I'm going to just quit school. I'm going to quit work. Like, none of this shit makes me happy. This bitch gonna make me kill myself. This job gonna make me kill myself. I can't pay for school. That's gonna make me kill myself. I may as well at least be happy before I kill myself. Like, let me just like make this music. And that's why I want like, just full force. Like, I quit everything. I had like $7,000 left over from like selling drugs and spent that on equipment. I bought the studio I was interning at, like their extra equipment, and set up my own studio and just like almost damn near became famous. Man, that shit was doo-doo. Like the first shit was in my homie's basement, Eric Beckwith. We used to get fucked up in his house because his parents didn't let us do whatever we wanted. And it was like 3 a.m. We like three bottles deep, fucked up, and we used to freestyle and shit. And Eric's like, hey man, you need to record that, man. This shit's the truth. I'm like, you're right, man. Like, how? And he puts his Mac up, you know, and puts it on the side, you know, a Mac open like this. He puts it up like this, and he's like, just put your face right here and cover the top. It's like a booth. So I got my face like this into the Mac, and I'm just like, hoes, hoes, hoes. Cause you know, when you first rapping, you don't know what the fuck you're talking about. You just talk about hoes and shit. And like, it was terrible. It was all garbage. I was bad at music for like 10 years. I just got good at music like this year. But yeah, it started off in the basement of my homie's house. We used to just get fucked up and yell into the laptop and auto-tune it. And then my parents got me a microphone like maybe 2 months later. I just started recording in my kitchen. I used to be in the kitchen waiting for my mom to finish cooking and shit. You done? Shut up, move. And then like I just start going crazy, just start making my beats going crazy. So probably like 2007, 2008, that's when I had the little Radio Shack mic and I was yelling at my homie's computer screen. And like, I probably didn't, I didn't like have my meltdown until like 2015, 2014. 2014 is when I had the meltdown, and that's when I went full in with music. So from 2007 to 2014, it was just like 7 years of just like, I love music, I quit. I love music, I quit, you know what I mean? And then like, once I realized, I got a chance at this, you know? Like, this is like the only thing I'll ever make multiple millions doing. I can't afford college, you know? Like, I ain't got no white friends who can just give me an awesome job, you know what I mean? And like, and this is like what I do. Like, I'm almost just gonna keep doing crime. Like, you know, I do drugs. I can't sell drugs. I'm not good at this. I keep doing them. Like, these niggas trying to kill me. These niggas trying to kill me. Like, what do I do? Like, get the fuck out of this city. Let me rap. It all started at the same time, really. Like, my sister is such a boss. She's like my big brother, but she's my younger sister. And she showed me how to use FL Studio. Like, I remember one day I heard boom, boom, clap, clap, boom, boom, clap. But I was like, that's a little jig, little jug. So I walk in the kitchen, I'm like, what the fuck is this? And she got FL Studio. We had FL Studio for years, but we didn't know how to get out of that little pattern box. You know, you click the lights and it plays a little loop. We never knew how to use the piano roll. And Paige is just smarter than me. And she figured out how to just open up the piano roll. She right-clicked. I ain't never right-click on no shit, you know? I was born in 89. I saw floppy disks, typewriters, home phones, you know, like, so right click, what the fuck is right click? You know, she right clicked on the fucking shit, and all of a sudden there's a piano roll, and that's how I started producing. My little sister like figured out how to open up the piano roll, and we started going crazy. And then like a week later, I was like, man, I'm gonna put some raps on this shit. And I was in my homie basement, like screaming into his computer. And then like 2 months later, my mom was like, here's a shit mic from Radio Shack, you know, like, go to school. Yeah, that's so funny. Damn. I remember I came to my parents, bro, with this like big ass like poster board. This big ass, I had a poster board and I had a PowerPoint because I went to a white people school in high school. So I learned how to use those things. I'm a millennial, like a motherfucker. And so I came to them with a real plan. And I was like, I need $500. I need this many shirts. I got this show. I'm trying to make this happen. La, 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 la. And my dad just got to laughing at my ass. He was like, oh. Motherfucker, we ain't giving you shit, you stupid boy. Take your ass to school, la, 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 la. Stop quitting your job, stop getting fired, stop getting locked up, la, 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 la. I was like, I'm just looking at my dad. I was got to crying. I was like, you don't believe me, nigga? One day, nigga, I'm gonna be Kanye West, nigga. And I was crying and shit, screaming. And you know how you like, you try and break some shit and then run away before your parents can catch you? I tried to flip the table and it went up and like landed on my toe. So I like hurt my toe real bad. I just had to sit down. I was just sitting down crying like, Kanye, nigga, like hold my foot. And now my parents are so supportive. Like, we're like on different pages now, you know? Like, they saw me going through all the phases and like watched me become an actual person. Like, I used to just be a fucking hedonist like everybody else. And, like, now I'm only halfway a hedonist, you know? Like, now I'm like 50% human. It's dope. When I made the song Forward with Chance, it was just like, it was raw as hell. You invited me to the studio, so I was already nervous as shit. It was like, oh man, isn't it, oh fuck. You know what I mean? Like, he probably just knows like a lot of bad things and like mixed with some good things. It's like, you know, like, I don't know, you know? And so you're in there and you're just thinking, you know, like, fuck, like, this is really fucking important. This could like alter my path, you know? So like, I can't fuck up. It's just, and that thought alone can like make a motherfucker freeze up. But you just gotta just be fucking tenacious. Like, fuck it, if I suck, I suck. Let's go. I know I suck. Y'all don't know I suck.
Parlay with a nigga like me. West side chicken dinner gizzards with some iced tea. Down, down. Uncle Remus, if you with it, I'm a fool with it. I'm too gifted. We too lifted like new spirits.
With Twista, it's just fun because Twista's like my fucking uncle, bro. Like, he's literally just like me, but like older. You know what I mean? Like, we smoke the same amount of weed. We watch cartoons, we play video games and shit. Like, we just be having fun. Like, a session with Twista, we might not even get no damn music done. You know, like, it's usually just him just asking me not to break things. It's just like, can you stop? Can you not crash into that? Can you just, like, chill, bro? Smoke this weed, chill. Come kick it over here, you know? It's just fun as hell. It's so much fucking fun. And then when we do create, it'd be easy as hell, because, like, he's a fucking genius. He rap fast as hell, and he be writing that shit fast as hell. So when he's like, and hitting that shit, and like me, my little boy, the little boy inside me activates, because like I used to listen to Twista growing up. I'm from the west side of Chicago, he from Chicago. I grew up listening, my father, my uncles, we love him. My family is a Twista family, you know? So I'd be hearing that shit, I'd be thinking to myself, I used to stand in the mirror, like preparing for moments like this, like not literally that moment, but think to myself, like, I'll outwrite this nigga one day, I'm gonna rap with this, now I'm gonna la 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 la. And I'll be trying to outwrap him, obviously, but like, we just, like, it's just fun. It's crazy to think, like, I used to sit in the mirror and listen to Kamikaze and rap Kamikaze. And like, you know how you a little boy, you ain't got no muscles and you put this part of your body for it, so it look like you swole this shit. I used to do this in the mirror, just be like, and rap Kamikaze, bro, weird as hell. And like now, like I'm actually like kicking to this nigga, like just smoking and making music. So like, it's just be fun, bro. It's one of the few payoffs in life. It's one of those few things where it's just like, this is one of those things where it's like, I'm doing it. I never thought I would do it, and it's something I actually wanted to do. You know, like as a kid, I actually wanted to sit here and kick it with Twista and write songs with Twista and like do that. And like to do that is like, it's just one of those things where it's like, life's not so shit. Like, it's like, there's some sweet parts, you know? My biggest struggle is just like depression, and not in the sense where it's just like, oh, I'm sad and angry, but like mine comes in like, cripples me. You know what I mean? I'll be sad and like, I can't leave the couch type. I'm not depressed where it's just like, I'll be sad and I'm mean to everybody around me. I'd be sad and just like, I don't even have the energy to be mean. Like, I don't have the energy to do shit. Like, I'll just lay on my couch for like 4 days straight and not do a fucking thing. Like, one time after Kanika Jenkins, I almost said murdered. It was proved or not proven. The courts say that she wasn't murdered, that she walked into a freezer, la 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 la. I got my own theories on that. I don't want to cause no trouble because I don't want to disrespect her family and like bring heartbreak. But yeah, reading about that, it really broke my heart, because young black women, women of color in general, and women in general are shit on and not looked at as equals or people. And especially black women go missing, especially in my city. There's hundreds of black women missing. Nobody gives a fuck. It's never on the news. No one talks about it. No one wants to lend any help. But if a Susan is hurt, if a Susan goes missing, if a Becky's gone, then the whole nation knows about it. You're getting Amber Alerts on your phone and shit. And so it just got me in a real morbid state where I was just thinking about the value of myself and the value of like my community and how like really in America niggas ain't shit comparatively, you know, how motherfuckers like view us and treat us and la 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 la. And like those types of things are things I can't avoid, and they're all around me all the time. And like just things like that will just trigger me. And so like that triggered, like I played Grand Theft Auto for 36 hours straight. It was double XP. I made $11 million. I went crazy, but I was sad the whole time, bro. And like all I could do was sit on my couch and play GTA and like look up facts about her death, because like I couldn't get over the fact that it's just like, it's 2017 and I'm still not shit. It's 2017 and like my sister's still not shit. My daughter might not be shit all in their eyes. You know, it's 2017 and motherfuckers, like things can just happen to us and like there's no repercussions. It's just sad. It's sad when you think about it. And it's wider than that. That's just one example. It's just little things I can't help. The way the world is just sad. It just makes me sad. I don't like what we were born into. I feel like it could be better, and I won't see it be better in my lifetime. It's too many problems. For the last 8 months, I've just been working on myself and learning how to cope, because I think a lot of men in general don't know how to cope. That leads to a lot of things we've been talking about earlier, like how women are treated. You know, like men shit on women and hate women because like some girl did something mean to them, and they don't know how to cope with it. They don't know how to move forward and just like, oh, she said no, I can't cope with it. Oh, she said this, I can't cope with it, blah, 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 blah. But I'm just like trying to learn how to cope myself. Like, this song didn't do what it's supposed to do. I gotta cope with it. There's something wrong with that. Like, this, I gotta do something about it. Like, my life isn't where it is or where I want it to be because I didn't do the shit I was supposed to do. I gotta cope with that shit. Like, I'm black. Like, I gotta cope with it. Like, this is things you gotta cope with. And as you learn to cope healthily, in healthy ways, you know, before I used to out pop a Xan, like, I would feel so much, have a panic attack and, you know, get sweaty, get teary-eyed for no reason. No one, everyone else is just having fun at the party, and I'm just thinking, like, child abuse. I'm black. Life is intense. My project might flop, and, like, this thought system will just, like, fucking crush me, cripple me. And you know, before, I had to pop a Xan, and now it's just, like, I think to myself, like, just fucking breathe, like, relax. Like, it's okay, man. Like, you gonna swim or not, bro? I'ma swim. Okay, good, swim. And just keep moving forward. It helps me just like keep moving. I'm dropping visuals with Cole Bennett. That's my homie. Me and Cole like came up together in Chicago. I used to be in this band called Hurt Everybody, and like hand in hand, like we like worked our way up to the top. I really fuck with Cole. But Cole like super took flight recently, like is a full blown star now. And like he's a real nigga. Like he just still be showing love, like still reaching back. Like I know he out here charging niggas arms and legs for videos and shit, and like we don't charge a nigga shit because like we've been like homies since like the start, you know what I mean? And like that's rare as fuck in this industry. It's a lot of these niggas I fathered, a lot of these niggas like I put on this show, gave you this, gave you that. Just like, come on, let's get this shit. Let's work together. Let's be like New York. Let's be like Atlanta. Like, let's all put our fucking numbers together and all be fucking stars. Like, let's go get this money. But like in Chicago, it's such a crab in the bucket mentality. Like, if you meet somebody who's actually gonna like give you the energy back, the time back that you gave them, that's a fucking blessing. I honestly thought I was gonna die when I was 27. I'm not gonna get too far into that, but there's a lot of factors leading into that. And growing up, my family's very empathetic. Empathy meaning like I can feel feelings. I can feel how you feel, I can feel, you know what I mean? Even if you don't say shit to me, I know what it is regardless. Even if I can't put it in words, I know what it is. And I think empathy comes with a lot of different things, understanding. If you understand, your brain can put things together. And sometimes the things that you put together and dream and think about or deja vu about end up coming together. They actually happen in the future. It's not premonition. It's just like you so in touch that like your brain can put that possibility together. And I feel like I have that a lot. And I've had it a few times and it's been so key that like I kind of lean on it. If I get that feeling where I have a dream, I can smell something, I can feel something too good. It's like, let me remember that. I'll wake up and write it down or something. And I just have this reoccurring, or had this reoccurring dream where I was bleeding out my stomach and I get into a lot of issues. Like, it doesn't even matter, but like issues happen. And I had this like, just, I got stabbed, I'm bleeding out my stomach. And in the dream, like I'm trying to call one of my exes who I'm not talking to right now. And then we were together at the time. And in that dream, I'm not talking to her and like she won't pick up the phone or whatever. And I had a other girl I was trying to call who I assume is the girl that I'm with now, but I didn't even know her then, you know? And I'm just thinking like back and forth, like, damn, should I call so-and-so? Should I call so-and-so? Should I call so-and-so? And I was 27. I knew it was 27 because like everybody kept saying like, you're too old for this, Freddie. You're 27. Like, look at you, you're dying now. Look at you dying, you fucking dummy. Like just everybody's just around me like, look, why'd you do that? You know? And so I tried really hard to not go outside my whole 27th year, all last year. I just turned 28, like October 4th. Now I'm going outside. But last year, I think I went outside like 10 times. I'm not even exaggerating. I like left my house like for functions like 10 times just because like every time. And those 10 times I went outside, I almost got shot like damn near like 3 of the 10 times. You know what I mean? And like almost got jumped. I did get jumped one of the times, defeated them. Check my Twitter for the video. And I felt like I was going to die or kill myself just because of the pressure. Like I just didn't have any joy in my life. You know, I found joy with my family and I found joy through legitimate accomplishments, not cosigns, not big numbers, but legitimate accomplishments. This is a song I worked hard on. This is a comment I really like. These people really enjoy this part of my art. They actually understand what I'm doing. But I've been feeling a lot better lately. Like for like the last 8 months, I'm working on Finally Dead. And it started off as just really like an obituary. It was really like just dark and sad. And now it's becoming like actually like eclectic piece of thoughtful work, you know.
Fuck my life, they say I'm hard like 36, I need a brick with the magic, with the witch, I quit, underlay, bruja.
My plan was literally, I was gonna finish the project, I was gonna take all my best songs, I used to have like 300 songs on SoundCloud type shit, take all my best songs, like the best 50, along with this new project, put it all on iTunes, put everything my sister's name off myself, just so like, at least something good will come out of it, you know? Like, I can just keep living and, like, ride this wave till it burns out and just be a fucking dude-ass until I do this anyway, you know? What the fuck? Like, let me leave something for Tegan. Let me leave something for my sister. But then I just realized, like, that's just, like, goofy-ass thinking. Like, that's not even, like, how adults think. That's just some childish, like, pipe dream shit, you know? And it's just hard. It's hard to think straight when you just in distress, you know? Like, everybody reaches that point where it's just, like, I don't even know who I am. I don't know where I'm going. I don't know what I want. Like, what is this shit? Like, you know, I'm not an afterlife believer. I don't believe in no afterlife. I just think like, once you're gone, you're gone. So with me, it's just like, damn, should I just keep persevering? Should I endure this? Should I be tenacious? Or should I just like go to the silence? You know what I mean? Like, it's just like one or the other. But right now I'm feeling like, you know, like fuck that. Like, well, get this money. Like, let me focus. Like, let me get my shit in order. Like, let me make sure like my family's right. Let me help raise this boy. Like, let me do all this shit I need to do so I can keep moving forward. I don't got no kids. I got a nephew. I really love him. He looks up to me heavily. And like, I feel like so that he don't land where I am, so he don't end up like rapping because he can't go to school because he fucked up too much and la 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 because he did this, because he did that, because he did, you know, like, if I can do anything, I can at least help him through that shit, you know? So right now my focus is literally like getting to a point where I can't be denied and I can finally flourish and move and make the moves I need to make, the money moves I need to make, so I can money move my ass out this fucking snake ass industry and get to live in real life, you know? Like for me, like, I don't give a fuck about parties in the hills and all this shit that everybody else likes doing, all this shit. Like, I be at these, just like, what the fuck? Like, who, fuck you, you're an asshole. Like, you're all fake, you're all phonies, you're all sad. Everybody's on drugs, like, what the fuck? Like no one's happy. Everybody's just, it's just all a temporary ass. Like, it just, all I see is just like the word temporary when I be outside. And the only time I see forever is like with my family. And like, so I just try and focus on them and like doing whatever I can to augment their lives, make them better.